Well, I think it must have been in high school when I took an art class there. And they taught us, we were printing the school newspaper in this class. And so I learned how to develop black and white film. And anyway, that's, I guess, where it started. I didn't think about it for years. Actually, before high school, when I was 12, on her last Christmas, she gave me one of those Kodak cameras that said, "Open me first," at Christmas, and I had that. But it wasn't until years later, when I'm shooting everywhere, that I realized, oh, she also was a professional photographer in Poulsbo, so thank you, Grandma. When I was working in Ethiopia in the 70s, for 2 years, I was doing physical therapy at a clinic in Asmara, Ethiopia. And a friend's husband had a SLR and handed it to me and said, "Why don't you use this?" I had no idea how to use it. At first, I had no idea about the f-stops or anything. And by chance, I just happened to get a beautiful photo of one of the young women in there with the hair all braided close and just a lovely person. And somehow I had managed to get the background out of focus, so that this girl just popped right off the screen. And I thought, wow, this is really cool. And then I started to ask how to do the developing and everything. And then I'd get these slides back, and I was always just so. And that's where it started, from these beautiful people in an interesting, very interesting place. So lucky me. These shots were taken in the Danakil Desert, which is in mid-Ethiopia. And there are sulfur salt flats. It's so hot in this desert that it's 120 degrees commonly. And the only way in and out is by camel train, which most of the Ethiopians use to go in once a year and get the salt and take it out. It's quite a sight. This is a girl who brought her brother to our clinic with polio and needed braces, and so she brought the child to us, and we were able to give him some braces. Yeah, this one photo here that was taken in Ethiopia in a very remote part of the country up by South Sudan. It's not a pleasant shot in the sense that it shows someone looking at me in an angry way as I take her photo. And I felt like I was taking advantage of her in some ways. But it's a shot I just cherish because it shows just how different people are and how beautiful they are. Sometimes people ask me why I went to Africa. And I think the inspiration for it started with National Geographic magazine that I love to read. And I had seen some East African photos by a photographer named George Gerster. And they were so, so amazing that I just thought, wow, this place is really interesting. So then when I graduated out of PT school and had some experience, I thought, well, why don't I see if I can get a job over there? So I did. I got a job, which was a really amazing opportunity. And the interesting thing is I actually met that photographer, George Gerster. Somehow he was there visiting some friends from the Kagnew station. And I asked him, you know, what would he suggest in terms of photography? And he said, well, there's three really important things. One is shoot a lot of film, because you only need one. And also don't shoot landscapes after 9 a.m. or before 3 p.m. So I always remember those simple tools, and that helps in many ways. So that was really fortunate. Well, I think the key for me, the key piece of equipment, and I'm not sure when I got this, was a enlarger I bought, not expensive, but nice. And that was when I was still living at home, when I was going home between the university and Olympia, where Mom lived. It's hard for me to remember exactly, but I had this enlarger, and I kept it all those years. And it was sitting in the closet for years, until our daughter moved. Then her bedroom was free, and this old enlarger suddenly, I'm looking at this and thinking, oh, I've got a room. All I did was I just put black curtains on it and sealed them, and no water there, but in the other room there was water. And so then I must have been, I don't know, 49 or 50. I'm trying to think how old I was when Becca moved. But that gave me the opportunity, and then lucky me again. It just worked out, and it was a big enough room where I could have all the different phases of liquid, anyway. So I guess she was the inspiration in that case. I did love shooting the children. They were so spontaneous and cute, and occasionally I got shots I really loved. This was one of the ones I really did like. Yeah, this little girl in black and white is one of my colleagues from the school district, the granddaughter of her, and she was so darling, I just couldn't resist. Yeah, this is a black and white of Jennifer and Jessica, Mark's cousins and my nieces, and they're both so beautiful. They almost look like twins in this shot, and they're really special girls. And this is another shot of Jessica Linke, one of the two nieces, and I added some hand coloring to it. It was kind of fun once in a while to do that, but she's another beauty. And every time anyone comes to visit for the first time, they always say, oh, who is that? And I get to tell them that's my daughter-in-law, Robin, whom we dearly love. Well, this is my beloved son, Mark, with his dog, Spanky. And if you look closely at the photo, you'll see that Spanky is almost on the move. There's just a slight bit of movement you can see in the picture because he was always on the move. Actually, they're quite a lot alike, Spanky and Mark. This is a photo of Father Jean Vanier in the Catholic Church blessing our daughter Rebecca, who was the last child at the time to be accepted into the Tacoma Larch community. This shows how much he loved her, and it shows how much we love her. In order to learn how to do photography better, I took several classes, and one of them was downtown Seattle at an art store. And the guy who was teaching it talked about, there's this old guy in Tacoma who knows all there is to know about black and white photography. And so then after I was done with the class, I just, I'm gonna track this down. And so then I met Bruce Bleckert, who was, had a professional black and white studio and workshop. And so I went down to see it. It had three or four enlargers, and you could shoot on the floor and get them really big or whatever. And I just thought I'd gone to heaven when I walked in that room. So I took classes, because he was teaching classes at night all along with all kinds of different people, you know, just odds and ends of us. And I took his classes for several years, and that was really helpful. So he was quite an expert. This is a shot taken of the new Dungeness Lighthouse with infrared film. And even though it's black and white, it's one of my most favorite shots of the lighthouse. There's something abstract about it, but it's just dramatic in that photo. We had the opportunity 3 weeks out of our lives to go over to Dungeness Spit and be keepers of the lighthouse for a week. So we got to live with two other couples in the lighthouse, in the keeper's house. And then when people walked out to the end of the spit, which was 5 miles long, and then we could take them up in the tower, show them how it worked and show them the light. And it was just a really fun thing to do with our time. Yeah, I took that shot of the lilies from a red kayak that my husband had gotten for me on my 29th or on my 49th birthday. I came home from work at lunch, and the red kayak was sitting in the living room of the house. A real treat. And nearby across the freeway is a forest that has the trilliums, which are common in the rainforests here in Washington State. Yeah, these are shots of birds, particularly eagles. Most of them were taken at Squim, where we would stay frequently at all times of the years, for just at the other end of the spit than the lighthouse. And there's a couple of them there. The two eagles in the tree were taken in our yard, and also the eagle flying towards the camera was taken in our yard. So those are lucky that we live in such a place as this. The heron also was shot in Squim. Heron, for me, represents a transition somehow. Because they are comfortable in water and on land, and they transition sort of between life and death. I can't describe it. Yeah, I was never really a sports fan particularly, but when you got into high school and got into swimming, I started to think, now wait a minute, how do you do this? With a person is swimming, you're moving. And so I had lots of opportunity to learn. And so I would go down and I would try to, the camera wasn't fast enough to focus with the person moving toward you, so I would focus on the floating line of the pool. And then when he got there, I would get the shot, if I could, with his head out of the water, not in the water, my son, Mark. So, and he was a state champion 2 years in a row when he was in high school and went on to swim for the Huskies. So I had lots of opportunity to at least shoot that one sport. Well, when I was about 6 years old, my family went to visit some friends that had a house on Lake Crescent. And somehow that beautiful blue lake just captured my imagination. And from then on, I always thought, I want to live on a lake. And in the end, I married a man whose family lived on a lake. We bought their house and have lived here for 35 years. And the inspiration was that beautiful lake. Even in black and white, it was beautiful. But that was the inspiration for that. These are a couple of wedding shots I did of a friend's beautiful daughter. And frankly, I went into business doing weddings just so that I could make enough money to buy new lenses and the equipment needed. But I liked doing it, but it was a lot of hard work and I was getting old. So I did it for a few years, but that's all. When I turned 50, that I began to realize that this is too hard for me. Shooting weddings was fun, but it's exhausting and I had all this equipment and I'm getting older. So I thought, well, maybe I should just switch to painting if I could learn how to do that. It's just an idea of how I feel about Steel Lake here. At the end, there's a lagoon. Then I'm picturing myself standing back or in the kayak back in the bushes on the other side. But it's sort of a magical little private place that you can go by yourself. The big painting there of the tree at the trailhead at Claylock, that's a symbol of how much I love that place. Since as a child in my teenage years, Mom and I would go with the McFall family, her best friends, who had a son a year or so younger than me. Every year we would go for at least a week to stay at Claylock in one of the big cabins with a fireplace. And we would explore the logs on the beach, clam dig. Usually we'd go during clam season, which was the low tide. And And then the moms, the two women, Vi and Mom, would have me help cleaning them, which of course I hated. But we would clean the clams and they would chop them up and can all of them. So they'd have clams for clam chowder all year long. But the beach was so beautifully wild with all the drift logs changing every year. And that trailhead just is an emblem of all the fun that we had there. And then there's a couple of other photos here. There's one where I've taken clay log and imagined the rocks to be a little bigger that are there and put my husband John in the photo because he loves it now too. Then the tiny one with the trees and Mark, my son, walking into the trees is another view of an island in the river, the creek there at Clay Lock. So that's been an important theme for me, just living and knowing that place and now introducing my grandchildren to our grandchildren, not just mine, because John loves it too. The last one there is a view of Dungeness Spit from the spit, looking back over Dungeness Bay towards Port Angeles. And somehow I just managed to capture the way it looks at a certain time of day, maybe twilight or morning. As a child, I spent almost the first 10 years of my life living in a logging camp on the Olympic Peninsula at Nea Bay. And my dad was superintendent of logging for that area. He loved to fish. And in 1952, he decided to have a friend of his from Paulsbo, a boat builder, build him, my dad, his own boat. And this boat, it's not very big, but it was perfect for what he wanted. And he could just keep it. He had a boathouse across from our house, and every year I was, after the boat was built, I would see a logging crane come down and move the boat, the tiny boat, from the water to the land so that he could be working on it all winter in the boathouse. And it was really his pride and joy. I think the story goes that he went into the woods and chose the tree for the log, for the wood, to have this boat built in Paulsbo. But this was my dad's absolute love, the symbol of him. Is this boat, and it was on this boat that he died. Well, I did get to go out fishing with him a few times, and there was one fishing derby in the neighborhood where we all went out, and of course, Dad practically got the fish for me, and then I got the bike as the person who won. So, anyway, that boat was, I could just feel his relaxation when he got on the boat. Yeah, this is a shot of the Renton house when the kids moved there. And then a lot of these other ones came from that. It was just so much fun to find something and be able to record it as they had children. There's one of Robin with Bryn and Lila as a baby, and there's a song coming out of this woman's mouth that is "This Little Light of Mine." And I'm pretty sure I made sure that the notes on the painting matched the actual notes from "This Little Light of Mine." That, I think, started me, but actually before that was this painting I did where I'm imagining Bryn in the forest. And the thing I love about painting is you can put the people you love anywhere you would like them to be. And so putting my first granddaughter in the forest with the rhododendron trees, that was doing that. And this next one is Bryn and Lila. Lila's in the front part here of the photo. Bryn's in the back because she's the first one. And they're sailing on Seal Lake on these little sailboats, which we have one, and they can sail on. Then there's this whole row in the background here. I think the first one is Lila. She's so athletic, and she does cartwheels over the couch. So that was my way of acknowledging that. And then the second one there is Emily when she turned one. And that shot or that painting reminds me of what they do when their kids are learning how to walk. Then the next two paintings are of Robin with both girls, Bryn and Lila, before Emily was born. And the last one is added Mark. And gee, there's only one of Mark. I just realized that. And then there's all three children, and that's the last one. It's interesting how life flows, and my luck at having that wonderful job in Africa is one of the reasons I met your dad, because they had at our church back home, they had a photo of me on the bulletin board for a while, and your dad saw it and thought, I guess I should contact her. Lucky me, again. It seemed like it was just by chance, but I guess it wasn't, because we've been married for 43 years, and I am so grateful to John for being so good to me and for loving me so much. To sum it all up, I guess, I could just say that I am so grateful for the opportunities I've had in my life. For the fact that I could do physical therapy in Africa and learn how to use an SLR camera with the beautiful people there. And then when I'm home, the idea of being able to have a dark room in my house for 10 years. And that gave me an opportunity to do the photography. When I got to the age where I needed to slow down, I switched to watercolors and was able to get some really good landscapes and family portraits where I was able to put people where I really wanted them to be at times. I'm so lucky, and I thank my family for doing this. Thank my son, Mark, for doing this.